I would like to welcome all of you to my kitchen. My name is the executive chef. But let me tell you exactly what I do. I have studied cooking all my life. And when they advertise in the hotel that they are hiring someone to be the master chef, I went and I applied. But unfortunately, they told me, you are not qualified. I said, how come? I cook the most amazing dishes in the world. And how come that you don't want to hire me? They say, no. We don't hire chefs who are good in cooking. I say, what? You don't hire chefs who are good in cooking? You hire them if they are good in what? They say, you don't understand. The most important skills that you need to have if you are going to work as a chef is accounting. So what do you mean by accounting? They said, we are operating in a hotel and we want to figure out how can we minimize the cost of the meal that we serve to the customer. So we can keep the same tests, the same ingredients, but we can minimize the cost. So in that way, we can make more money. And you, if you understand accounting, you will figure out exactly how can you give the same experience to the customer with the least cost possible. So I went and I studied accounting and I understood exactly how to prepare the most delicious dishes. I can make a chocolate cake with no chocolate. Yes, I can only add all the ingredients that need to be there to make you feel with the actual taste of a chocolate without any cocoa powder inside. And I will make you enjoy actually amazing dishes where you will think you are eating fresh vegetables, but actually it's all based on the ingredients that I had there by minimizing the cost. I learned that and I worked for so many years as a chef in so many hotels. But then after, when the economy was bad and they had to let me go, I decided to use my skills in a different area. I understood that the same way I used to cook actually all these dishes by manipulating the ingredients and figuring out exactly how what to include and what to include, I can apply it in reality in what we call it the accounting, the financial world. Because what these executives they do when they are doing accounting, they are actually cooking the books. They are deciding exactly what financial information to include and not to include, and how much out of this financial information they want to include. And this is why today I am coming to you here to present a very interesting proposal. I'm going to teach you exactly how I cooked all these financial books in all these organizations that I worked in, and I made this organization appear that their financial statements are delicious. They are rich. They are making money. But in reality, they are actually having fictitious revenue. They are actually suffering from cash flow. But no one discovered that until smart auditors or regulators uncovered all these fraud schemes. So the first question that I would like to ask you, why do smart managers make bad financial decisions? And this is always, a very interesting question. How come no one will look at these numbers and will figure exactly what's wrong with these financial numbers? And I'm going to show you exactly all the tricks that I use in my cooking to trick these financial managers so they will not be able to uncover the actual fraud that I do. So when we look at the income statement, all the numbers on the income statements are fake. What? All the numbers on the income statements, on the balance sheet, on all the financial reports are fake. What's the meaning of fake? The meaning that all these numbers are created based on estimates and based on assumptions. The meaning I, as a chef, I can change these numbers and make them appear very delicious, or I can make them appear not that interesting. So in that way, I will avoid paying taxes, or I will make a lot of investors interested in my dishes, in my financial statement. And the only number that is true on all these financial records, they are the cash. Cash is king. Cash is the only number. So profit is an estimate. The meaning, which revenue you consider is recognized and reliable, we can record it. And which expenses you consider we can account for it in this year, we can record it. In that case, whatever profit left here, it's an estimate. I can manipulate all the numbers completely legally. So in that case, accountants, they are making, you know, judgment decisions. And based on these judgment decisions that we make, we say, okay, this expense is for this period. Because of that, this expense is for that. This revenue is recognized. This is not recognized. This is accounted for based on different accounting principles. Remember, we don't have laws related to accounting. We don't have actually other than standards and guidelines. The meaning, these are not rules and laws. The meaning, we can figure out the proper way of manipulating the financial information the same way I manipulate my dishes without anyone asking questions, and it's completely legal. So accountant should actually give the accurate image of what's happening to the performance of the organization. But what they do, they create amazing shining financial statement and they leave this actual information in the footnotes somewhere for you to read, which is nobody will read. When you get my menu, do you read on the bottom what I said in the menu? I said these dishes are not including the additional taxes and this and this and this and that and these dishes. And actually, I wrote half for you down that the actual ingredient used to use the chocolate cake is not actual chocolate. You don't read the footnote. You just read the big, amazing chocolate cake and you order my chocolate cake. For that, all financial decisions are based on judgment. And in that way, I can change the decisions by changing the financial information that I give you. So because of that, because accountants, they are making this judgment, they can manipulate the information and they can decide exactly what to include and what not to include. And as long as they are following the guideline and the standards, there is nothing wrong with what they are doing. So in another word, they are cooking the books. Exactly. And this is why I decided why I'm going to spend my life working as a chef in a kitchen, making a little bit of money, compared working as a chief financial officer and cooking all these books and making so much money. I can make millions. How? I can just decide the assumptions, which is what ingredient to include in the dishes. So if I'm making a pizza, I will do double cheese, double revenue this year. Take the revenue from next year, put it in this year. And I decide the assumption, how much to include of this. Is it double cheese or triple cheese? What about the onion? Onion is not good. So that way we take it out. Expenses, we take it out. Mushroom, you don't want mushroom. Take it out, the expenses. So this is why, based on the assumptions, what to include and what not to include in the balance sheet, in the income statement, and based on the estimate, how much to include from each item, I can manipulate and cook the financial statement completely. And all the results that you are going to have in your financial statements, they are all based on estimates. Estimates only. So these numbers that you trust and you publish and analysis, they rely on it, and investors and banks, they are actually no more than fake numbers created by executives by cooking the books. And we can see thousands of cases all over the world how these executives, they manipulated the books. And I'm not saying all the numbers in the world are fake. If we ask the questions about the assumptions and the estimates and figure out exactly how they came up with the numbers as auditors, as investors, as banks, we will be able to assess if they are real or not. But if we don't ask these questions, if we trust the numbers and we believe in them, this is going to be a disaster. So this is why I'm here today, to tell you how you need to look behind the numbers, to understand what are the assumptions and estimates behind them. Let me explain some of my recipes, right? If you buy my book, you can read all my cooking recipe related to the financial statement. Let me start with the first one, the first chapter related to increasing revenue recognition. Do you want to make your financial statement more delicious, more attractive? This is what you do, the first recipe. So write it down, because maybe you need to cook it later for your organization. The first recipe, we call it round trip recipe. So this recipe is very important. Why? If we want to report more revenue, even we are not making revenue, we can do that. We can go to one of our vendors and we say, hey, vendor, we have to pay you actually 3 million. The vendor, they say, yes. I say, how about we pay you 4 million? And you go and give us this 1 million back as you bought our services and goods. He say, but I don't want your services and goods. You say, no, you don't understand. You are not actually going to buy them. We are not going to give them to you. We are just going to give you this 1 million extra. Then you are going to give it to us as if you bought our goods and services. And in that way, we can report that we have additional 1 million revenue. But the vendor will say, but late. I understand accounting. In that case, you are not going to report profit. They say, yeah, we are not interested in profit. We are startup. We want to show to investors we have so much revenue and so much expenses, but at the end of the day, we don't have profit, which is okay. It's not a big deal. As long as they see revenue is going up, we will tell them in the future, we optimize our process, we reduce the expenses, we make money. So this is the first way of manipulating the process completely legally. Oh, look, we paid the vendor and the vendor pay us. We have all the paperwork in place. Do you think external auditors will uncover this? No, because everything done properly. This is the first recipe. Let me tell you about another recipe, which is interesting. Defer of revenue. So sometime what will happen? Do you know the customer had to actually pay us for 2 million. And some of this 2 million related, and all these 2 million related to this year profit. But this year we have so much revenue. So in that way, we are not gonna account for it. What we will do? We will take 1 million and we record it for this year revenue. And we take 1 million and we say we are gonna record it next year. So in that way, this year we appear, we have some good revenue. And next year, because we are expecting maybe we will not make so much revenue, we take some of these revenues for next year. So this is the recipe of deferring. Like I have so much extra cheese. I will make you a pizza now with some cheese. I will keep some cheese for later because later I'm short on cheese. So I will appear, I have always cheese. So in that way, I can manipulate the revenue and in that we trick the investors to show them that every year we are doing well. And there is another way for me to do this is by doing what? Rather than deferring the revenue, I can book them prematurely, like what Xerox did. So Xerox did this by booking them prematurely rather than deferring them. So what they did, they have actually leased 4-year lease for their photocopying equipment, and they recorded all the 4-year lease today, and they overstated their profit by more than 6 billion. Of course, when the government discovered that, they were not happy. Xerox, bad, very bad. Also, the other way, what we can do channel staffing. So company, they try to inflate sales. So by the end of the year, what they do? They go and they tell their, you know, customers, listen, buy the products from us. The customers, they say, but we don't need them. They say, no, you understand. It's the end of the year. Buy them today. We record the sales today. And in that way, we can ship them to you. And don't worry, we will pay for the cost of the storage for them. And in that way, in front of our auditors, we can say we have made the sales. And next year, if you don't need them, don't worry. Return them back to us and we will take them. But in that way, we record them as we have did the sales this year. And in that way, we inflate our revenue completely legally. As long as the customer will accept, nobody will discover that. The customer will say yes. But the customer, they didn't pay for it. So this is when we use analytical procedures later, we can identify that some of the sales that was happening at the end of the period of the year, customers returned and they didn't pay for it. And we discover someone is doing cooking here. What about reducing the expenses? What about if you want to cook this dish to make it really sad, to make it really reduce the ingredients from this dish? You can. How you can do this? Usually, we need to follow a very interesting principle called the matching principle. So we need to match the expenses related to the revenue we make in this year. But we can manipulate that. The first recipe that I'm going to share with you called capitalized expenses. So what we do? We have expenses. We need to expense rather than we expense them in the income statement. We capitalize them as assets. So in that way, we depreciate them over a long period of time. Is this possible? Of course. Look what we can do. Look what, and you know, and they did in waste management. Waste management, they say, we have expenses. We need to depreciate our assets. But if we don't depreciate our assets over this period of time, we can keep them as assets and we can depreciate them later. And that will reduce the amount of expenses we have. And this is what they did. They took their dumpsters, their trucks, and they expand their lifespan. So in that way, that will reduce the amount of depreciation they have to pay. That increase their profit by 3.5 billion. Very interesting. And completely legally, they say, look, we expand the life cycle for them, the lifespan, because we are going to use them for a long period of time. So the most important question you need to know when we are dealing with profit, what is important? Is it how much money you make? Or how much money you keep, or how much money you borrow, or how much money you spend. As a financial executive, what is the correct answer? Write it in the chat or the comment. Which one is the most important one? When we are speaking about that, it's always about the net profit, the meaning how much money you keep. I don't care how much money you make. You may spend them all. I don't care how much money you spend. at the end of the day, how much money you keep, what is the net profit after being all your expenses, and are you going to convert this net profit into cash? Because cash is king. Look at this statement. This statement from Aaron. And if you see the statement from Aaron, you can see what's happening in the statement from Aaron. In the statement from Aaron, you can see that the revenue is doubling every year. Oh my God, look at the revenue here. Look at the revenue here. Look at the revenue. The revenue is doubling. But when we look at the income is not increasing that much. So what's going on? How come that the revenue is increasing and the income is not increasing? And how come we see, if we read the rest of the statement, that actually even the assets and revenue is increasing, income and cash is not increasing? So these are questions we need to ask. What are the techniques that Aaron used to cook the books? Aaron used a very interesting techniques to cook the books. They want to show they have revenue and assets. So how they did it? They said easy. They went and they created special entities. And at that time, if you have a special entity and you don't own more than 50% of that special entity can go and borrow money from the banks. So these special entities owned by Aaron, it's borrowing money from the banks, reporting to Aaron that this is the revenue from the activities that they don't have. And then because they are less than 50% owned by Aaron, they are not going to be consolidated on the financial statement. So in that way, Aaron is reporting so much revenue from the special entity, so much assets we have, but actually we have no cash because all the money we got from this organization, we spend them on our losing project, on our expenses, and it was disaster. And they did it completely in the proper legal way until they got exposed. And this is what we are saying. As a chef, as a financial executive, as a chief chef financial officer, I can manipulate the books and record in the proper way. I can manipulate all this balance sheet to be able to show you exactly whatever I want, as long as I know how to cook properly. Look what WorldCom did. WorldCom, they have all these, you know, rooming expenses related to their international customers. So rather than expensing them, they capitalized them and they increased their total assets by 11 billion. Also, this is a very interesting technique. These expenses, you need to expense it. You can't capitalize it, but this is the technique they use. What about manipulating the goodwill? What's the meaning of the goodwill? If I go and I buy other companies, there is the goodwill. The goodwill is how much the price I paid minus the net assets for this organization, which is assets minus liability. But I can actually go and pay large, massive amount for this organization. But actually, this is not the amount that I should be, just to increase the actual goodwill that I have for this organization and trick investors in believing that this is what's going to happen. And then what will happen to this goodwill? I can amortize it over maximum period of time. But actually, the rules change. They say, no. This goodwill is not going to be amortized. This goodwill is the value for it is going to increase and decrease based on the concept of impairment. So that way you can buy an organization, next year the goodwill for it will increase. And all of this is based on estimates and adjustments and based on experts' opinion, and all this can be manipulated. And this is the cool thing about it. This is why Tycoon, they did one of the largest fraud ever by going and buying 600 companies, and they increased the goodwill for this organization. And in that way, they were able to show that they overstated their assets by billions over a long period of time. They bought 600 companies and they manipulated them by the concept of goodwill and increasing the value of these organizations. At the end of the day, cash is king. This is what Warren Buffett said. If your organization, you don't have cash, you will not be able to survive. So what we need to do for you to uncover all these schemes that are done by all these masters of cooking inside your organization, you need to understand that profit is not equals cash, that we need to always turn this profit into cash, and we need to look at the cash inflow and outflow. Go and analyze the cash statement. Cash statement is very important for us to go and analyze. Go and analyze the cash statement, because by analyzing this cash statement, you will understand exactly, how can this organization generate money. So for example, is this organization generating money from actually the financing activity? They are borrowing money from the bank, or are they generating activities from actually the investing activities of the banks? The meaning they are actually selling their assets and making money, selling their assets, or are they generating money actually from the operation, from the core operation that they do? So cash statement is very important. All right, now this is why when you are actually looking at the financial information, you need to understand very important concept called from a book called Blink. They say professional who have knowledge and experience, sometimes they make decisions without using their mind. And sometimes these decisions, they are not gonna be correct. Because you have experience for 25 years in financial world, you will believe when you see something, you will spot it. But these fraudsters, these masters of cooking, they change the games. So you will not find the new tricks. You need to always make sure you don't rely only on your intuition. You need to analyze and look at the record. Because sometimes the first look is deceiving. You don't see the big picture. You don't see what's happening. So what is the solution? The solution is very simple. For you as a financial professional, you need to ask yourself four questions. The first question you need to say, what are the assumptions behind the numbers? Number two, you need to say, what are the estimates used to create these numbers? Number three, you need to say, what are the bias? What are the manipulation that happened related to these numbers? And finally, what are the implications? What are the issues that can affect the investors, the banks, when these numbers are being presented? Are they presented for the banks for you to get more money or for the investors to get investors? So are someone manipulating the assumptions and estimates to create biases so in that way investors and bank will invest? And the most important thing, who's controlling the organization? Are the numbers controlled by the chief operating officer and the CFO, or they are created by the accounting department without influence? If someone is affecting and influencing these individuals inside the organization, that can be a disaster because the numbers are created by management. They are not reflecting the actual operation in the organization. At the end of the day, I will tell you that based on all the fraud that I have done in the past, I decided to quit. I actually decided to leave the corporate world and I'm not doing any of this financial cooking. And I came back to my kitchen doing amazing dishes and I'm using actual ingredients. But for you in the financial world, go back and look at these numbers and always ask these four questions and always try to look beyond the numbers that are presented to you. Try to use the advanced tool and analyze them to be able to make sure that no one is cooking financial numbers and giving it on your table saying it's an amazing dish. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoy my presentation and I hope that you will come one time and try my dishes, but they are real.